let's start a tour of the cell. I'll introduce principal cell structures and then demonstrate the experimental approaches that we use to identify their functions in the cell. Let's start by looking at a cell fractionation scheme. The cells are first ground up and homogenized, and then the sample is subject to differential centrifugation, which is a series of spins in which pellets containing smaller and smaller subcellular components are isolated, eventually leaving behind the cytosol. As you'll see, isolated subcellular structures can be examined in the microscope and then analyzed biochemically to establish or confirm their function or functions. Let's start with the nucleus. The upper TEM shows what a nucleus looks like in situ. That's Latin meaning in place, in a cell. This is, of course, a cross-section of the cell. The lower cartoon should remind us that the nucleus is surrounded by a double membrane, that the double membrane is perforated. It has nuclear pores. This double membrane is called the nuclear envelope. And the nucleus itself contains chromatin, DNA bound to proteins. And this chromatin is embedded in a nuclear matrix surrounded by nucleoplasm. Because it's the largest structure in the cell, you'd predict that it would sediment or pellet during low-speed centrifugation. This is a TEM of isolated nuclei. We believe that these are nuclei because they look like nuclei, and they're about the same size as nuclei that we see in situ. What predictions about this cell fraction could you use or test to confirm that these, in fact, are nuclei, and not some strange artifact of the cell fractionation process? Let's look at mitochondria. In animal cells, these are the next largest organelle. Like nuclei, mitochondria are surrounded by two membranes, an inner one and an outer one. It is, of course, not perforated. There are no mitochondrial membrane pores. The cartoon at the left emphasizes the double membrane and the familiar elaboration of the inner membrane into cristae, which can also be seen in the transmission electron micrograph on the right. Look at the cell fractionation of mitochondria in TEM on this slide. Actually, these structures don't look a whole lot like what you would see in situ in cross-sections of cells, but they are about the same dimensions as mitochondria. Knowing the respiratory function of mitochondria, what would you do to confirm that your fractions are indeed mitochondria? Here are some experimental tests. You could check to see if the isolated structures would oxidize pyruvate or other substrates. What other substrates might you test to see if they're oxidized by this cell fraction? You could check to see if the isolate would convert ADP and inorganic phosphate into ATP, another function of mitochondria. What are some other experimental tests that you could do to prove that your isolated cell fraction are indeed mitochondria? Think about those things. We may have a chance to discuss them face to face. Okay, in this slide, we're looking at chloroplasts. The TEM on the left shows a typical chloroplast, although they often have different morphologies depending on the source, the plant they come from. And the cartoon illustrates this organelle in three dimensions. Chloroplasts are also organelles surrounded by an inner and an outer membrane. In this case, the inner membrane invaginates, that is, grows inward, to form thylakoids, the stacked membranes seen in these illustrations. Of course, the chloroplast is the site of photosynthesis in green plants and algae. At the end of a day, plant cell chloroplasts will be filled with starch, which is formed when the sugar made by photosynthesis is converted into the storage form, the starch polysaccharides. At that time, a structure is formed that's called the leucoplast, which is there to store carbohydrate energy that the plant can use at night. What are some experimental tests that you could do on an isolate of chloroplasts to prove that you've isolated chloroplasts, say, from mitochondria, a similar size structure, slightly smaller, but, you know, similar size? Some time ago, it was shown that isolated mitochondria and chloroplasts both contain DNA and RNA, and that they in fact replicate DNA and transcribe the DNA into RNA and make their own proteins, independent of the nucleus and cytoplasm of the cell that contains them. This suggested an endosymbiotic theory for the origin of these organelles, in which primitive eukaryotic cells ingested either a bacterium or a blue-green algal cell, but for some reason failed to digest them. Instead, the bacterium became an endosymbiont reproducing and providing energy to the host cell. Likewise, the blue-green algae, or cyanobacterium, evolved to become an endosymbiotic chloroplast. This illustration places the endosymbiotic origins of mitochondria and chloroplasts in the context of an evolutionary tree, showing the evolution of all life from a single ancestral cell, that progenote. Might be hard to imagine a primitive eukaryotic cell that could host an internal symbiont, because most eukaryotic cells already have all the familiar organelles. But here's one that actually exists today, which lacks all organelles, basically, except the nucleus. This is Giardia, it's a parasite, and this cell, or one like it, could have swallowed up precursors to mitochondria or chloroplasts sometime way back in evolutionary history. Let's turn our attention now to ribosomes. This illustration summarizes what we know about them. They're composed of two subunits, a large one and a small one. Each subunit is composed of one or more ribosomal RNAs and 21 or more proteins. Prokaryotic ribosomes are smaller than those of eukaryotes. The difference in size is in part due to larger ribosomal RNAs and more ribosomal proteins in the eukaryotic subunits. As you can see from this slide, we measure the sizes of the ribosomal RNAs and of the subunits themselves in what are called S units, named after Swedborg, the fellow who devised a technique to actually separate molecules like ribosomal RNAs and these small particles in the cell, the ribosomal subunits, by centrifugation. We'll talk more about that technique when we get to talking about ribosomes in more detail. Continuing with a little information about ribosomes, you should be able to find free ribosomal subunits and polyribosomes or polysomes. Polysomes are ribosomes assembled on a messenger RNA molecule and may be attached to membranes, which means they're bound, or not, which means they're unbound. Bound polysomes are attached to rough endoplasmic reticulum and the outer membrane of the nuclear envelope in eukaryotes, and are the site of synthesis of proteins destined to leave the cytoplasm, which we would call packaged proteins. Think about this question. Where might bound polysomes be found in a bacterium, in prokaryotes? In this slide, the left panel illustrates a cell containing inactive ribosomes, most likely as separate subunits. The cell, in this case, is from a dried out or desiccated desert plant called the resurrection plant. After a few hours, this plant, when placed in water, becomes metabolically active. And by 6 hours, the cells are actually synthesizing new proteins. The panel on the right, then, is a transmission electron micrograph of such a cell that has been hydrated, showing that the ribosomes have now clustered very clearly into short polysome chains. That brings us to the end of this presentation. We'll pick up with our tour of the cell in the next one.